For thousands of years, the feudal societies of China and Japan were ruled by warrior dynasties that sought to expand their power through military victory. It was from this environment that an elite warrior class known as the samurai emerged. The samurai was a master swordsman who could strike with his sword using 1,000 different combinations. These techniques were cultivated in 12th century training centers for samurai. It wasn't until the conclusion of World War II that the secretive Asian origins of the martial arts were openly revealed to the world. Today, a new martial culture has developed with over 5 million participants in the US alone.
Scorpion 1, Scorpion 1, this is Scorpion 2.
One of the most dramatic developments in this new world of martial arts is the transformation of the US Marines into a complete martial culture for lethal and non-lethal combat.
Request permission to move up on the objective and neutralize the enemy. Over.
Roger. Permission granted.
Since its inception in 1917, the Marine Corps' officer training base, Quantico, has been on the front line of military innovation. Quantico is a think tank, creating cutting-edge military doctrines, training, and technological advances. And it is here that a new program was born, which redefines the mindset of today's Marine warrior. Quantico is the headquarters of MCMAP, the Marine Corps Martial Arts Program. The motto is simple: every Marine a rifleman, every Marine a martial artist. This saying had its origins in Vietnam.
MCMAP pretty much started with a young Marine lieutenant back in the 1960s when he was a commander in Vietnam. And what he noticed that the North Vietnamese, or the bad guys I'll just call them, they were always infiltrating the American lines. And to his flank were sometimes an organization called the ROC Marines, the Republic of Korea Marines. And they would never be infiltrated. And so he was wondering about that one day, and then he realized that one of the reasons they were never infiltrated was because they were always practicing martial arts. So you zoom forward about 15 years, and now this lieutenant, who's a lieutenant colonel, who is a battalion commander of 3rd Battalion, 9th Marines, decides that he's going to put a martial culture or martial arts into his battalion. So he goes and brings in martial artists to teach his entire battalion martial arts. And so he had a very unique battalion, and the Marines loved coming to work. It was a challenge every day, and it was fun. Zoom forward another 10 or plus years, and this same lieutenant colonel is now wearing 4 stars, and he's the commandant of our Marine Corps, General James Jones. And one of the things that he started in 1999 was our Marine Corps martial arts program. We have 3 disciplines. We have the physical discipline, the character, and the mental. And the physical one is the smallest. It's the one where we actually have 172 techniques, which you'll see out there in the LZ today, the landing zone. Where the students actually get to throw each other around. The ones that we are most proud of that makes us a little different than other martial cultures is the mental piece and the character piece. The character piece is pretty much living your life as a great American, doing the right thing 24/7, so that it's not just when you're a Marine, but when you go out there in the American public, when you get out of the Marine Corps, you're gonna take the culture of that character and the mental piece, the things that we're really proud of, and take it out there to make a better society for our American citizen.
Right there, Again, I did block it that time. It was a little bit higher.
The students are taught by the men in black. The senior McMap instructors are quickly identified in the field by their black shirts and expert martial technique. But it is the black belts that they have earned and wear around their waist that really distinguish them. The training is diverse and physically demanding. On this day, the 220 men and women of Bravo Company will perform a series of rigorous evolutions designed to build leadership skills and instill teamwork through the mindset of the martial arts.
Some of the physical fitness training that these Marines do will be worked into not just your upper body development, your cardiovascular, you know, you get martial arts training incorporated into a monthly training plan.
The Marines develop the warrior ethos by facing down their own fears in the octagon.
There's a lot of fear when they go inside the ring here, the octagon or anything. But as soon as they get it on, the fear goes away because they don't want to let themselves down or embarrass themselves in front of their peers. And so as they're going through this martial culture, this martial arts, it's building a lot of confidence in them based on experience and training so that when they go out there and deal with it, they do really well with overcoming fear.
If he's moving around on you a lot or if he wants to come out real aggressive, just give him a nice sidestep, okay? Because what he's going to do is he's going to come right flying, give him that same parry, and then you can butt stroke him to the head or get a nice jab, okay? So a lot of people don't think there's a lot of power in that forward thrust, but guess what? There's a bayonet on the end of that. You don't need a lot of power.
As the Marines progress as martial artists, the training techniques they employ become more sophisticated. For the most advanced Marine martial arts students, there is the ultimate challenge, the Instructor Qualification Training Program.
The Instructor Qualification Program is a very intense program. We have two classes a year, and they're 7 weeks long.
Many Marines that qualify for the program are unsure of exactly what the 7 weeks will entail.
First thing they do is when they arrive here, we give them a Marine Corps PFT. That's running the 3 miles, the dead hang pull-ups, and the 100 crunchers. They have to do that, and they have to make a first class. If they don't make a first class PFT, then they get to go home. We start throwing them right into the mental portion, which are classrooms. Teach them all kinds of good classes on how to be a better leader, a better trainer, a better instructor. We're always doing some sort of fighting. We'll do ground fighting. We do stand-up fighting. That's where they fight myself and my staff. We do things we call the Last of the Mohicans. That's where we take them out in the woods, make them run a course, and at the very end of the course, they have to take on the instructors. And the instructors will have either a bayonet, or they could have a weapon of opportunity. It could be a stick or a club. They could also have a knife. It could be two-on-one. It could be one-on-one. It's a very tough course.
The unexpected can cause fear, hesitation, and confusion. The mental aspect of martial arts training can instead teach decisiveness and the will to persevere over the most difficult of circumstances.
We see through the period of 7 weeks, their whole mental and their whole character begins to change. They become more confident in themselves. They become more confident in their abilities to teach. They grow up awful fast in 7 weeks.
In the end, the culmination of all martial arts is a personal journey that is unique to each individual. In life, there are many paths to choose. Each path has a beginning and an end. At the end of each path is a doorway that leads to the beginning of another. For some, the martial arts are a conduit leading to many unexpected doorways, journeys that can lead to the highest level of consciousness and enlightenment. This is the paradox of the martial arts.
I started martial arts when I was 9 years old in Singapore, and I had no idea what it was. It was judo. At 15, I got involved again in judo, jiu-jitsu, stuff like that, you know, Bruce Mackinnon and whatnot, and it really took to it, really liked it, enjoyed it a lot. Did a lot of jiu-jitsu, you know, a lot of judo, then took up karate. I thought karate was a lot of fun at that time because you didn't have to grab anything. But I started to think about karate, that what I was doing with the karate just wasn't right, because it's too stiff and jerky. It works in its own field, its own game, but outside that I had serious doubts. So I saw some people way back, because I'm an old guy, so way back when, I saw some people doing some fluid motions. I said, what's that? And it was a Kung Fu thing. Nobody knew of Kung Fu back then. I mean, nobody. So I got involved with this, you know, Kung Fu stuff, this Kung Fu crowd, and started to get involved in the internal martial arts, Tai Chi, Aikido, that kind of thing, Bakwa. So I kept going and moving in that direction, you know, ease of trying to grace and ease rather than, you know, strength and struggle and fight against the opponent.
You asked.
And eventually started to look around and say that there's not anybody doing exactly what I wanted to do. And so I started to put together Chengxin.
In 1975, Peter Ralston founded the Chengxin School of Martial Arts in Berkeley, California. Then in 1978, he became the first non-Asian ever to win the World Championship Full Contact Martial Arts Tournament held in the Republic of China. Accepting all challenges, Peter has never been beaten. He is so sensitive, he can respond to what an opponent is doing often before they know they're doing it.
Every time you're going to kick, go ahead. At your leisure.
You move in as soon as my leg comes up.
Yeah, so you tell me you're going to kick every time. Right. So every time you're going to kick, you're going to tell me I'm going to be somewhere else. Better not tell them.
It has often been said that speed is the essence of the martial arts. Peter exemplifies this ideal with a triple punch combination that appears as one. Peter has pursued this endeavor with passion and determination for more than 35 years and now devotes his martial arts training to developing a higher level of consciousness with his students through an apprenticeship program.
In this particular program, for 7 months, they're going to be training. Now, they'll be training in the martial domain mostly, but they'll also be training mind. We'll do different exercises on intention and clarity and being on purpose and being honest, do a lot of contemplation and work through a lot of, as if mental, emotional, spiritual type considerations. And then there's 3 weeks of martial, in which I'm going through many techniques and unfolding the art of Chengxin Tui Shou. We do a little sword, work on body movement, body being, effortless power, things like that. When we finish that, the people doing the month-long go away and the apprentices stay, and I'll continue to work with them. And every day, they will learn something new, some new techniques, work on a principle, day after day after day. And they'll be training these things all day long. We'll also work with mind. From time to time, we'll do intensives in which they have to make some kind of mental breakthrough. They have to have a shift in the state of their being in order for us to stop the intensive. These are very rigorous. When everybody makes this shift, we go home. If it doesn't, we stay on until they do. It's a very rigorous program. And the kind of shift is something they have to do. And also the way it's set up is that it's not necessarily easy to do. It's not just something. They have to change something, see? They have to rise to the occasion.
The founder of modern-day karate, Jinshin Funakashi, said true practice is done not with words, but with the entire body. You must train until you fall from exhaustion. What you have been taught by listening to others' words, you will forget very quickly. What you have learned with your whole body, you will remember for the rest of your life. Enshin Karate is the embodiment of this philosophy. This intense training is directed towards the Sabaki Challenge, a full-contact, knockdown karate tournament, a tournament that is international and open to all. Danny Coleman by day is a computer programmer. Before and after work, she trains to fight in the Sabaki Challenge. Why does she put herself through such a rigorous regime?
Once I started training, I just couldn't really imagine life without it. I get so much out of it in all aspects that it just seems like a part of me.
In 2003, Mike Ninomiya was the middleweight Sabaki champion. His goal for the 2004 competition is to move up in weight class and compete in the heavyweight division. Mike has struggled with the paradox of using fighting to improve the world and himself.
Fighting, for me, isn't about winning or losing. You know, like I said, if your mind is here, you're worried about yourself. And then so it's got to be out there. You're not worried about yourself. You're not worried about success or failure.
Both Mike and Danny's teacher is Grandmaster Ninomiya, whose decades of training have created huge calcium deposits that in effect give him fists of iron. Mike, in addition to competing in the tournament, is the son of Grandmaster Ninomiya. Growing up apart from his father, they were reunited 2 years ago. Mike is now a live-in student at the dojo.
This is my room back here. So we have a curfew every night. It's at 12 o'clock. And we always try to take care of our bodies.
Mike has intense admiration for his dad.
A lot of people, they look at his knuckles. You know, that's a lot of people. Karate is about punching and kicking. And but when he smiles, his face really lights up. And, you know, it reflects who he is as a person.
The martial arts divide into three broad areas: handheld weapons, striking, and grappling. In grappling, Hiroshi Ikeda, an Aikido master, demonstrates a neutralization called grounding. The effect of grounding is to make an opponent weak by apparently applying some kind of force that makes it difficult for him to move, while Ikeda Sensei remains mobile and strong. Watch in slow motion how Henrik acts as if a weight were being placed on him. Invited to analyze what is actually going on during grounding were two PhDs in physics, Jim Roberts and Chet Netter.
Okay, let's see what happens when Hiroshi tries to ground Henrik in a grounding technique. Let's see what happens.
All right.
Okay, it looks like Henrik's experience of force here. He's struggling against. It looks like a pretty substantial force, wouldn't you say?
Definitely. I'd be curious to see how the weight's distributed when this is going on.
Well, should we try and measure it?
Sure.
In order to measure the change in weight distribution, Jim and Chet will put Ikeda Sensei and Henrik on two large digital scales.
Okay, first let's make a measurement of the two weights without any connection at all.
So we see here that Hiroshi Ikeda Sensei weighs about 185 pounds, and Henrik over here weighs about 196. So Henrik, why don't you grab Sensei and we'll see how the weights shift.
Sensei's weight shifted to 155, approximately.
And Heinrich's is up to about 227, approximately. It's fluctuating a little bit there, but
it's changing a little bit. 160 and 221.
So what happened?
In the grounding technique, there was clearly 20 to 30 pounds of weight transferred from Ikeda Sensei to Heinrich. And it seemed to be enough to make Heinrich off balance, and it was difficult for him to maintain his posture when that weight was transferred.
Force is being transferred through their arms from one person to another. In this case, Sensei is basically giving Heinrich some of his weight, making it more difficult for Heinrich to move because he's effectively heavier.
Another factor is where the weight's transferred. If the weight is transferred in a way that Heinrich is comfortable with it, for example, if he had a backpack on or if it was sitting on his hips, he could handle that weight pretty well. But the fact that it's at the end of his arm tends to unbalance him even more because he's having to carry that weight essentially at a distance.
Basically, the weight's off center. It's off his center of mass. So when you have a backpack on, all the weight's coming down through both your legs, straight down through your straight body. Whereas in the case of if you're pushed off back a little bit, then that weight's kind of behind your center of mass, and you tend to tip over.
As for the additional 6 pounds generated by grounding, further investigation will be needed.